So I'm teaching two courses at the department product development at the University of Antwerp. The one thing is all about material selection in the product development process. And the other topic that I teach since 1995 is eco-design. And thank you, Tine, for inviting me to bring my story regarding a selection of beverage packaging, a critical and logical approach. All right, so what is a sustainable and circular packaging? Yeah, there are different criteria to take into account. And first of all, the packaging should fulfill all the desired functions. Then, of course, the question for today is, fit the packaging in the circular economy? And that, of course, with the limit of the environmental impact. And these topics, I will look at it in this small presentation. Afterwards, it's possible, of course, to ask your questions. And of course, now in the chat, when a question pops up, you can already write your question in the chat. But after my short presentation, there is a possibility to talk about. So first of all, the packaging should fulfill all the criteria that is needed. And of course, the main purpose of a packaging is to protect the product through the value chain. Then there are also other criteria to think about as a designer of designing packaging, that the packaging should be adapted to industrial processes. Think about the filling installations, think about labeling, etc. Also, the packaging should fit for the user. That's one of the topics in design, user-centered design. So the packaging should be easy to open, or sometimes not to open. Think about all kinds of chemicals, etc., that are packed. But looking at the user convenience is also a topic. And of course, by legislation, there are a lot of criteria regarding communication, what is in the packaging, and also all kinds of things to preserve the product that is packed. Of course, I'm not going into detail of that. That's the topic of design of packaging. But for today, we're talking about circular packaging. And that is the scheme that is used nowadays very, very frequently. It is the butterfly model of the circular economy. All about these things you can find on the internet on the website of the Ellen MacArthur Foundation. They brought up the butterfly model of the circular economy. And a few words about it. So the butterfly, with a little bit imagination, you recognize a butterfly. And the body of the butterfly, that is the life cycle of a product, the life cycle of a packaging in that case. And it all starts with the raw materials. The raw materials are transformed into materials. We're going to make packaging out of it. We have the distribution chain. And then, of course, we end up with the consumer or the user. And in contrary with the linear economy, of course, we're not going to burn or drop the packaging on landfill. So we really should close the loop. Closing the loop is not new. We're talking about closing the loops since the 80s. But that model brings other criteria, other items, especially also new business models. I come into a while on that topic, new business models. But first of all, let's talk about the hierarchy in closing the loops. And I would like to explain it looking at the blue wing of the butterfly. And first of all, the first step we're going to take in the circular economy is looking for reusable packaging. Okay, the butterfly model was made up for all kinds of products. So regarding machinery and equipment, then we talk about, of course, for a long product lifetime and repair and maintenance, etc. But for packaging, of course, that is not the topic. For packaging, we look at reusable packaging. And then, in the end, the last strategy in the circular economy is recycling the materials. So it's very important to bear in mind that there is a hierarchy in closing the loops in the circular economy. So we have the blue wing regarding the technical nutrients, as we call it. Think about aluminium, think about glass. Eh? It's made out of ores, or sand is made, sand is the raw material of glass. And on the other hand, we have the green wing, and that is, of course, the cycle of the bio-based materials. Think about paper, for instance. It's the same strategy, of course. You see here the cascades. That means we also follow the hierarchy in closing the loops. So for packaging, first try to use reusable packaging. And when the packaging does not fit anymore in reusable systems, then one possibility is that we going to the bio-based packaging are recycled. So it's perfectly possible that the, for instance, bio-based polyethylene is coming into the technical recycling schemes of the circular economy. Or, of course, it's possible that the bio-based materials are transformed into, for instance, new biochemical stuff by biochemical reactions, or that the bio-based packaging is transformed in biogas. And another strategy, but that is not really perfectly organized, is composting the bio-based packaging. But that is a strategy, as for sure in Belgium, it's not a topic, because the bio-based plastics, for instance, they are not collected in the right bin. They are, yeah, they are burned here in Belgium because there is no good collection scheme and composting scheme. So nowadays, regarding the butterfly model, the blue wing has much more opportunities than closing the green wing based on the materials. Right. So this is the focus, the butterfly model of the circular economy. So I made for you a little presentation, as you can see, and I see it as a kind of a roadmap in the circular economy. And the first step is try to avoid or reduce packaging. And regarding eco-design, it is talking about life cycle thinking, but also about system thinking. So when we think about avoid and reduce packaging, we're going to tackle the complete packaging system. That means the product that is packed, the packaging, and the logistics behind it. So for instance, it's a very interesting strategy to sell kinds like this one, to sell some syrup that the consumer can use at home just by adding tap water to the concentrate to make the soft drinks. Tap water is running out at every home. We have tap water that is perfectly for drinks. So by that strategy, selling concentrate syrup, we avoid a lot of transportation because we have small packaging and we don't have to transport water, of course. Another example in the same strategy, a student of product development of Antwerp, together with some friends, he started up with a drip fill refill, and that is a kind of a vending machine that is placed on the workplace. And the same principle, the vending machine is connected with the tap water, and the taste is arranged by concentrate syrup, and also they have the option of sparkling soft drinks by adding CO2, of course. So at home, at the workplace, and I made a little literature study on the internet for making up that presentation. And I see some other same installations. An installation that we know for many years, that is the installation at IKEA. The same syrup is delivered at IKEA and the water is added in the shop. And we see now already in Holland, there is also a bar that is offering soft drinks from the tap just by adding some syrup to the tap water. Very interesting evolutions that fit perfectly in the circular economy and avoid a lot of waste and a lot of energy to transport the water. Another thing that we see that is pumping up is the packaging-free shops. I think we've seen it everywhere, not only in Flanders, I suppose, but also in Germany and the other countries. And that is that the consumer go to that to those packaging-free shops and with their own packaging, and they can tap the soft drink in the shop itself. That's, of course, a picture of whiskey and other liquors, spirits, the consumer can tap by himself from reusable bulk packaging. This is also a strategy that is coming up. And really, we should rethink the retail, the shops that we now know today. I think, I hope, within a few years, we see another shop concept. I hope that the principle of the packaging-free shops can have much more interest to the consumer and also for the retail. So avoiding by the refill systems, then the second strategy is try to use reusable packaging. In the B2B world, we see that it comes up much more and more. And in beverage, of course, we know the use of glass bottles for beer or even for wine. In Belgium, we have the Colruyt, and they offer wine bottles, reusable bottles. And of course, it's very important that the consumer bring them back. So we need reusable packaging with a deposit. So we are sure that we get back the reusable packaging. And a very important thing when we are going to reuse packaging, it is, of course, the economics of the situation. And it's so important then that we're going to use uniform packaging. So, for instance, the wine bottles that are sold by Colruyt, they are all the same. So it is economically interesting to collect and to clean and to, once again, put the reusable bottles on the market. The marketing is done by labeling, but the bottle itself, it is the same. Also think about the filling installations. Imagine that you have all those types of glass bottles, small and big and whatever, for different companies that will fill the bottles. It should be a uniform packaging, so it is fit for every installation. So these are two important things, uniform packaging. The marketing can be done by labeling and, of course, with deposit. In the project Circulair Verpakken from Vlaanderen Circulair, we have discussed already some problems, some bottlenecks. I come into that into a while. But first of all, one of the bottlenecks is the question, is reusable packaging, is it indeed much better environmentally better than single-use packaging? And the main topic is the question, how many times should the reusable packaging, how many times should that packaging be used to be better than the disposable packaging? And now, many years ago, that was one of my studies, I made up a calculation. And I calculated for the whole life cycle of the reusable bottle, the energy consumption, so starting from the raw materials, also the collection of the reusable bottle, refill, and in the end, recycle the glass. So for each step in the life cycle, I calculated the energy consumption, either from the reusable bottle and from the single-use bottle. And as you can see on that graph here, you see the energy consumption for each time we use the bottle, the reusable or the single-use bottle. And here we can see how many times should the reusable bottle really should be used, so the energy level is less than the throwaway bottle. And as you can see, the pink color, that is of course the throwaway bottle, because every time you use a single-use glass bottle, it's always the same, of course. Instead of the reusable bottle, then we can divide the energy that it was needed to produce the glass bottle. That energy can be divided by the times the reusable bottle is really used. So that's why the blue line, that is the line of the reusable bottle, that's why the reusable energy, the energy for the reusable bottle, that energy is kind of a logarithmic path that it is following. And to answer the question, how many times should the reusable bottle really be reused, we have to look at the break-even point. And as you can see, when the reusable bottle is reused two times, then the energy is less than the throwaway bottle. Two times, that is very, very small. Of course, I should make the remark that that calculation was made, of course, for a few assumptions. And I took Belgium. It is a small country, as you know, and a very important item is the transport distance, and I took it for 155 kilometers. I worked together with the brewery Palm, a nice beer brewed in Belgium. That is an assumption, transport distance around 150. And of course, as you know, the reusable glass bottle, you know, glass is very brittle, glass will break during the traveling through the lifetime. And I took 2% of break for every time we use the reusable glass bottles. That was very high. At Palm, they told me that they have a percentage of break, let's say maximum 1%. So that is a quite big assumption that I took. But the figure, of course, it what it is. But it gives you an idea that the glass bottles, that was okay. It was the case of the glass bottles, of course, that the glass bottles should not be used 50 times, 100 times to be more profitable than the throwaway bottles. All right. So as I mentioned before, in the project Circulair Verpakken, we have discussed some items. One of the items was how many times should the reusable packaging really should be reused? And I answered already the question for glass in the context, of course, that and the assumption that I made. And another bottleneck is, of course, the reversed logistics. And once again, transport is a very important item for that. The distance should, of course, be realistic. For instance, when we're going to have a distance of 500 kilometers or 1,000 kilometers, it's crazy to bring back the reusable packaging back to the bottling company. That is too crazy. So for my opinion, when we have a very special product, think about Ouzo, that is made in Greece, then we can use bulk packaging. Think about the packaging-free shops. So bulk packaging is coming to Belgium, and then locally we are going to fill the small packaging with the Ouzo. All right, so regarding this, for long chain globalization, think about bulk packaging and then fill locally. VIL, the Vlaams Institute for Logistics, sorry for the Flemish, is working on a project regarding empty logistics, how to optimize the bring back of the empty packaging. For the interested participants, a nice project to follow. Of course, another problem with reusable packaging is of course the cleaning process. And I must say that nowadays the companies that are cleaning the bottles or the packaging with water, of course, water is getting very scarce. We get water stress. So all those systems are focused on try to reuse the water. So it's not cleaning and let go the water flow into the sewage or, yeah, in worst case, the river, but they really going to try to reuse the water. Also, the cleaning product, they try to avoid water pollution, of course, by the cleaning process. Another topic that is also part from the Vlaanderen Circulaire, it's so important with reusable packaging that there are no toxic products left in the empty packaging. Think about with the festival, sometimes it happened that people are smoking cigarettes and they push the cigarette into the bottle. Of course, it's not done that the cigarette left into the bottle. And it's also a very nice project. It's all about quality control regarding the cleaning process, that there is no risk that toxic or think about the cigarettes are left in the reusable packaging. So there is a lot of investigation, a lot of projects that are working on optimizing the cleaning process of the reusable packaging. Of course, the cost, that's always the point to make the decision. and companies are making the balance between the cleaning cost and logistics cost regarding the use of new packaging. And especially with plastics, it's a problem because plastic has very low value. As you know, that 1 kilogram PE costs, let's say, 1.5 euro. You can make a lot of packaging with 1 kilogram. So there should, of course, be an economical balance between the cleaning cost and new packaging. But that's important to mention when we going to use uniform packaging, reusable uniform packaging over different companies. So companies will use the same packaging. Then, of course, the cleaning cost and logistics will drop because it will be much more efficient. And that's one thing. And on the other hand, during the crisis now and the bad times are in front of us, I fear. Huh? But the price of the raw materials will rise. So there also will be, once again, the cleaning cost, etc., will drop. And the cost of materials will rise. So it's very important as a company to keep an eye on that and take that into calculation. All right. So as I mentioned before, to be economical interesting, we need a lot of same packaging. And that's why we should work together. We are talking about today regarding beverage. And that's really a sector that it should be possible. We have a high value. We have a high volume, excuse me. Instead of think about perfume bottles. It's all about the turnaround time. As you know, today you buy a bottle of perfume and it takes maybe 1 year when the bottle is empty. And that is also a problem in reusable packaging. For long turnaround time packaging products. But for beverage, that is not the problem. The labeling A few months ago, I got a question. It was a small brewery, handcraft, as they say. And they glue the label on the bottle with a very strong glue that the label is not removable. Of course, to use reusable uniform packaging, we should, of course, have removable labels. Think about paper labels that are glued with a water-soluble glue, of course. Not only for reusable bottles, but also for recycling the packaging. It's also important to have, first of all, monomaterial. I come into a while on that. And then that when you need different materials, that they are able to disassemble. And a very important player is the role of the retail. And I would like to mention now a third word that is so important in the transition to the circular economy. We have mentioned for the first life cycle thinking, then system thinking, and the third magic word in the transition to the circular economy is chain collaboration. And the retail has a very important role to play by implementing reusable packaging, because the retail might be the partner, of course, that people will bring back the reusable packaging. So we should think about the split of the costs to close the loop of reusable packaging. Voilà, that I mentioned before, standardization, chain collaboration, marketing by labeling, and of course a high deposit or a higher than the 10 euro cent that is now today to stimulate the consumer to bring back the reusable packaging. And as I mentioned before, the circular economy invites us to introduce new business models. And one of them is packaging as a service. And there are a few examples already. For the takeaway, we have the Billy Cup, so consumers can buy their coffee in one of the bars, the coffee bars. They will pay, let's say, 1 euro for the cup, and they can hand over the cup in another bar and to recover the deposit. And also it's once again the glass bottles. In Lommel, in Belgium, there is a company that will offer packaging as a service. And it's about glass bottles. You can look that up. It is VT Logistics in Lommel. And they give the total service. So, for instance, a beer brewery will order glass bottles at that company. They will fill, of course, the bottles with nice beer. And then that company will take back the bottles in all the different shops after the consumer had brought back the bottles. And that company will clean them and put them back on the market. It's a nice example of packaging as a service. So, it's very interesting to participate those initiatives. And as we can see, the circular economy will introduce new stakeholders in the value chain. So that company is really a new stakeholder. It is a reconditioning company that pump into the life cycle of the packaging. And of course, with the new stakeholders, there is a role for the social economy. So the social economy, for those who does not understand what I mean, is that we have some people that cannot find a job in regular industry. They are not able to work on a high level, let's say. But those people, they can find a job in those cleaning companies, those companies that will recondition the packaging. So it's not only ecological interesting, but it has also a social aspect in the circular economy. We can think about, of course, the primary packaging, as you know, of course, the bottles and the jars, etc. But secondary packaging is also something to think about. Now we have the six packs, or we have sometimes promotional packs, etc. And we see a lot of plastic, or we see the transition to paper. But those solutions are single use and does not fit quite well. Fit a little bit, but not quite well. It can be done better. And regarding promotional campaigns, why do we need those plastics? Why do we need those paper to put the products together? Nowadays, we have also the digitalization of the world. So we can use the opportunities of digitalization for promotional actions. And of course, all the initiatives to bring also reusable secondary packaging on the market, I would like to put in the picture. Reusable boxes for glasses, and also that exists. Think about the crates for beer. These are small ones. The big ones already exist. But for jars, it's also very interesting to implement reusable secondary packaging. But maybe Tine will talk about on that later. Of course, I would like to use these examples in my presentations because it fit for today. And there are nice examples of the circular economy. And then the third step on the roadmap of the circular economy, we have here, first of all, avoid, limit packaging, reusable packaging, and finally, choose recyclable materials. So, of course, we have a lot of recyclable materials. Here we have a few of them. That is one question. What is a recyclable material? So the designer will have a contact with the companies that produce all kinds of packaging materials and will ask the question, is this packaging recyclable? But the second question, and that is more important, or even important, is that the designer will look at the possibilities of collection and recycling of the packaging. And that's sometimes a problem. The question is, fit the packaging really in a coordinated collection and recycling scheme? As I mentioned before, regarding compostable materials, well, they do not fit in a collection scheme, for sure in Belgium. So compostable packaging is not an option to use because they are burning in the end of the use. So they really don't fit in the circular economy. The problem answering that question is, of course, that collection and recycling is in every country different. So there should be, on European level, there should be a uniform collection and recycling facilities. Collaboration, not only in industry, but collaboration with all the stakeholders in society, and especially, of course, with government. And as a designer, we're going to integrate the design for recycling guidelines. And of course, one of the most important guidelines is try to use monomaterial. And I took from internet from some pictures from packaging that really does not fit in the circular economy. There are multi-layers. This one is coated with aluminium. These packagings, even they are collected here in Belgium with the PMD, with the packaging stream. Even they are collected, the consumer will drop them in the PMD bag, but they are burned. So this does not fit in the circular economy. And also the paper bottle that we see that Coca-Cola is trying to introduce, or Heinz tomato ketchup is looking at to introduce. Well, these options from my point of view, it's a way of greenwashing, because for the consumer, it looks like green, it's paper, and the consumer has the impression it's from paper, it's from wood, it's natural, it is okay. Well, it is not okay, because two things I would like to mention. First of all, the paper bottle is not, of course, paper by its own. Inside, there is plastic. When you pour Coca-Cola into paper, we will have a lot of problems. So it is a multi-material. So it is not recyclable. And finally, one of my big concerns, we see a transition from plastic to paper. We have the European plastic strategy that tells us we should avoid throwaway plastic. And we see nowadays that plastic is transplaced by paper. Well, I really have big concerns regarding that, because where will we get all that paper? Wood will be cut. The woods take up CO2. It takes 40 years before the tree that they're going to replant is as big as the cut tree. Making paper use a lot of water. I invite you to look that up on the internet, and use a lot of energy, because the paper pulp should be dried. The water should get out of the paper pulp. So making paper is not really a very ecological process. So using these paper bottles, from my point of view, it is greenwashing, and it does not fit in the circular economy. We also should avoid sleeves. So we have the PET bottle, and for marketing, it's nice, they say, to put a complete sleeve around the bottle. But those sleeves make it very complex to sort the packaging, and even make it very hard to recycle those packaging. So avoid sleeves. Sometimes we see packaging, and on the packaging is written, please take away the paper from the plastic, or please take away the sleeve from the bottle. But the question is, how many people will do that? And we ask something from the consumer, and we know that the consumer is lazy. Let's say only 25% of the consumer is really concerned about the environment, and maybe those people will follow the guidelines to sort, to take off the paper, take off the sleeve. But from my point of view, we should avoid it and take away the responsibility of the consumer. Monomaterial, use monomaterial is so important in recycling the packaging. Sometimes, of course, we need caps and labels. Now we have a new legislation that the lid of the back of the bottle should stick on the bottle. That is because they found a lot of PE lids on the beach. Yeah, the bottle was probably down on the ocean. But never mind, the legislation came up that the lid should stick to the bottle. That's, of course, in contradiction to the design for recycling guideline. But those bottles, they will end up in the PET recycling. Those bottles will be grounded, and then by floating, they can separate the lids that are made from PE from the bottles that are made from PET. All right. And then something interesting as an industry, it's keep an eye on the revolution, I call it, of technology. It's so important. We are on a crossroad in the transition to the circular economy. Industry is going to invest. And it's so important that the investments are in the right direction. And it's important so to follow the technology that is coming up. And in packaging, there is very interesting evolution. And I invite you to look on the internet to the Holy Grail project. And it's all about giving a watermark on packaging. So in the during processing of the, in that of case, the PET bottles, during molding the PET bottles, there will be a watermark on the packaging. We as a consumer, we will not see the mark, but when the packaging is coming into the sorting installations by spectrometry, spectrometrical devices, they can read the watermark, and then automatically the packaging will be sorted. So that will be a very interesting evolution. Take away responsibility of the consumer. Sometimes he thinks, where shall I drop my packaging? Well, by the, once again, the evolution, revolution of the digitalization, the sorting process can be much better, and also the recycling process. But keep in mind, with that technology, of course, the design for recycling guidelines should still be followed to optimize the recycling process. And something else that is coming up, very important to follow, that is the chemical recycling of plastics. So nowadays, since the 80s, we still remelt the plastics. And when we're going to remelt them, we can break down of the molecules, we have contamination of the plastics, we have a lot of problems. But now, the big industry, think about Exxon Chemical, think about the BASF, think about the big plastic producers, they're now investing in chemical recycling of plastics. And that means that by those new processes, that they're going to split up the plastic in new building blocks, and they're going to make new plastic once again. So the problems we have with remelting the plastics, like drop of the quality, it is washed away by the chemical recycling process of plastics. These processes, depending on the type of plastic, need a lot of energy. That's why those processes, although they still exist in the 90s, it took so long that the big plastic companies invest in those processes, because the energy demand is such high. But the plastic industry is getting really under stress. And we really see a revolution in the chemical recycling of plastics. And that will give a lot of more opportunities, that plastic fit much more in the circular economy. As industry, new revolutions to follow. And then it's of course important that we're going to evaluate circularity and the environment impact. And it's so important to know that it is not a story of black and white. The perfect solution does not exist. There will be always environmental impact. And we have to strive for, first of all, optimal circularity in combination with minimal environmental impact. And of course, with a compromise with all the other needs of the packaging. So it's try to find a balance. And for sure, there is no size fits all. Every industry should think, what is the best system? Remind the word system thinking, what is the best system for my product? And to look for partners and to collaborate so that the change the system can be economical in an interesting way. And also think about the business models, look for the new stakeholders. So once again, we need chain collaboration. All right, that's our few remarks regarding evaluating. And we can evaluate circularity and environmental impact by two types of tools. I talk about the qualitative tools. These are based on life cycle assessment or carbon footprints. And I also talk about the qualitative tools. And these are based on checklists. And those checklists are made up by the eco design guidelines. An example of an LCA, and that LCA was made up by the Swiss Federation. You can find the big document on the internet. I put the link on in my presentation. And it was for soft drinks because it's the topic of the day. They investigated a lot of packaging ways, and it's a little bit small, I can see, but maybe on your screen it's much bigger. But we see the reusable glass bottles and we see the PET bottles, and the environmental impact is nearly the same. So we have here all the types of beverage packaging and we have the environmental impact. The higher, the worse. So we have here the throwaway glass bottle. Yes, of course, glass is very intensive material to make and it's really bad to throw away glass bottles. My heart hurts when I have to throw away the glass bottle into the glass bin. Think about champagne bottles. It's so such a nice material. So of course, then we have also have a very high environmental impact. But based on that life cycle assessment study, we see that glass bottles, the reusable glass bottle, has the same environmental impact as the throwaway PET bottle. This is the result of one LCA. And I use these results because they fit in my story. They fit in the story of the circular economy. And I invite you to look on the internet and type LCA studies, beverage packaging, and you will find thousands of LCA studies. And you will see that depending on who has paid or who has made the study, the results are completely different. Because when we calculate the life cycle based on the life cycle assessment, or what is also coming up is calculating the product environmental footprint, it's also a figure. They're going to calculate a figure that say that's the ecological footprint of that product and that packaging, etc. The process of calculating started in 2007, and still they are not agreed how to calculate, because it is also based on life cycle assessment. And dear listeners, bear in mind when reading LCAs that LCA studies are, the results of the LCA studies are dependent from very different criteria. And especially, there are 1,001 assumptions that are made to bring the system in the picture that is based on the calculations. So be aware of the LCA results. For sure, I use now the LCA, one of the LCA studies in my presentation. It was made of an independent, I may hope, an independent organization. And the results fit in the circular economy. But when you read other LCA studies, bear in mind who has made the calculations. For sure, when you will read the LCA study of the paper bottle of the Coca-Cola, for sure, the paper bottle will be best. But the results are depending on all these criteria that I mentioned. And when I hear somebody talking about LCAs, I always ask, what is the deviation of the results? Mostly they say, that's figure one and that's figure two. But what is the standard deviation of the results? And often I don't get an answer. Instead of the previous slide, here we have kind of it's not a specific mark, but it's a kind of a spread of the results. For your information, one of the assumptions to calculate the environmental impact of the glass bottles was that the glass bottle is reused 40 times. One of the assumptions. All right. So The quantitative tools based on LCA studies or carbon footprint, be very critical when looking at the results, and bear in mind what system had they taken into account to make those calculations. And that's why I prefer the qualitative tools based on the design for X guidelines that we are using in eco design. So that means that we have all kinds of guidelines. I only have three now in my presentation, but it's a bunch of guidelines over the life cycle of the packaging, regarding what kind of raw materials, what materials, what is the impact on logistics, what is the impact on use, and especially what is the impact on end of life. And how we work with the checklist, that the packaging is confronted with all those design for X guidelines, and the designer, together with the stakeholders in the value chain, will give a kind of a value. Is it already very good, or is the packaging not good at all? So we give kind of a color, a kind of a value on the packaging regarding all those design for X guidelines. Coloring, giving a value, that is not the topic of the qualitative tools. It's a visual aspect. So in the end, you can see we should make an effort to make the packaging more recyclable, for instance. The colors is pure visual, but the strength of the making a scan with the qualitative tools, with the design for recycling guidelines, design for recycling and all design for X guidelines, it invites you to look for alternatives. Also, the principles of the circular economy are integrated. And that's the difference with LCA studies. With LCA studies, you need already a product because you need figures. But using checklists, you can use these checklists also in developing new products, new packaging. The designer can verify, am I good or am I not that good? Of course, checklists also have some disadvantages, and we need, of course, a lot of information to evaluate the checklist, and we need knowledge, and that's we need chain collaboration with the stakeholders in the value chain. And then a last topic, it's all about material selection. So of course, it's a very important question that we have to ask, what material fits best. Of course, different criteria. We need optimal performance to fulfill all the needs of the circular packaging. We have, from my point of view, we have to look to the health risk. Is there migration of chemicals from the packaging to the soft drinks, to the beer, whatever, to the product? And of course, the recyclability, that the material is recyclable without quality loss. Regarding health risks, I would like to invite you to look at those internet links. It's all about food packaging and the influence on health. It's about this trade-off, and you can see that every material has advantages and disadvantages. For instance, the can, it is not reusable because we have up till now no possibility to reclose the can. Maybe it's today. Maybe it's a question for innovation to invent reusable cans. But the problem will be when reusable cans are pumped up in the market. Metal is very plastic deformable. As you know, when you squeeze on the can, it will be plastic deformed. So it will be very difficult to bring back the cans without any bumps on it. Instead of the glass bottles, they are perfectly reusable, as you know for sure. That fits better. The bricks are not reusable because it's very hard to recondition, of course, the bricks. And the plastics, the PET or the PE, For instance, the PET bottle, there are PET bottles in Holland that are reusable, but it's a very special type of PET so that the PET bottle does not shrink during the washing installation. So that's why I gave medium for the plastics. Regarding migration risks, is only the glass bottle the good material? As you know, glass is very inert. So there is no contamination of chemicals with the food or the drinks. Instead of the other materials, even the metal cans, there is inside a very small polymer layer, because Coca-Cola, for instance, cannot be in touch with aluminium because there might be a chemical reaction. So there is a plastic barrier in the cans between the drinks and the material. So it gives also risks. I can refer to the reference in the previous slide of the Packaging Food Forum of Swiss. And then you can read, there might be risks of contamination of the plastic barrier of the cans. And also the bricks have plastic inside, so risk of contamination. Regarding the recyclability of the material without quality loss, of course, glass, we can recycle it for sure as we keep the white, the transparent glass separated from the green, from the colored glass, of course, no contamination. Then there is no quality loss of the glass. There will not be quality loss of metals. Also with the remark that there should not be contamination. For instance, the lid of the can should be of the same alloy as the body of the can. There is no contamination of the alloy. Then it is perfectly recyclable without quality loss. Paper. You can paper recycle 7 times. And then the fibers are too small. So there is quality loss with paper. That's why every time paper is recycled, new virgin paper fibers should be added, new wood fibers should be added to the recycling process. And regarding the plastics, remelting plastics give quality loss. The molecules will fragmented. But I give it orange because I mentioned before, there is a revolution in the recycling process of plastics. And when we talk about chemical recycling, then there will be no quality loss of the material.